வாழ்க அந்தனர் வானவர் ஆனினம் வீழ்க தன்புணல் வேந்தனும் ஒங்குக. ஐ எம் வெரி பிளீஸ்ட் டு பி ஹியர் இன் யுவர் மிஸ்ட் டு பி ஆஃப் யூஸ்ஃபுல் டு யூ in explaining the situation of the Hindus in Sri Lanka. I am very grateful to Sri Jan Foundation and the organizers of this meeting, especially the lady whom introduced me to you, for inviting me. I am very grateful to Mr. Ravi Raghavan, who suggested that I come to speak before you. I have with me a fellow Hindu worker from Canada, Mr. Adiyar Vipulananda, who has come all the way from Canada to be in Delhi with me. I did not come specially for this meeting, but I came to attend to some other work, but you have been very kind enough to invite me to speak to you. Past 400 years of our history has made us minorities in the globe. The entire globe has only one region where the philosophy of the East is prospering, but it does not end there. The Pope has declared that this is the century for Asia, indicating that even this blot in the globe has to be dissolved. On the other hand, Islam also has declared to be its intent that this globe is only for Allah. So with this bleak scenario, our focus is on Sri Lanka. This is where we are. At East Asia, we are 66,000 square kilometers of land, a mango-shaped island. The present population is around 2.3 crores or 23 million. You know, the entire region is a Hindu region. If not for the last 1,000 years of history, we would have been entirely Hindu. The Ramayana takes us to Sri Lanka. So, Hindus in Sri Lanka as old as Ramayana. This is the history behind our life. We were 100% Hindu just before the arrival of Buddha in Sri Lanka. We shaped our own culture, we shaped our own traditions, our language, our literature, our economy, our emotions, our personalities, on our own without much interference until Buddha visited the country during his lifetime, 3 times. However, we did not take to Buddha very seriously until Asoka's time. Even then, Buddhism did not make a serious impact. It did not make a serious impact. It merged with the traditions that already existed, the Hindu traditions which existed in the country. It took most of it as it in India. The Hindu traditions were merged and assimilated into the Buddhist tradition. So much so, all the values the Hindus have in Sri Lanka are shared by the Buddhists. All the traditions we have in India, in among the Hindus in Sri Lanka, are shared by the Buddhists. And not an iota of difference between us and the Buddhists in terms of cultural values. But only one thing which divides us firmly is the language. A language that evolved 1,000 years ago in south of Sri Lanka. The Sinhalese language. Before there were Tamils, the Tamil language was the language of the island. Period during which Adi Shankara lived and a few centuries before was the revival of Shaiva, Vaishnava and other sects of Hinduism in southern India and northern India. From, as our saint said, not from Buddhism or Jainism, from actors of Buddhism, those who acted as Buddhists and those who acted as Jains. The real Jains and the real Buddhists did not care, but those who acted as Buddhists or wore the garb of Buddha bhikkhus, they were the ones who were subject to attack by the revival, Hindu revival. And in South India, it was during the 5th century, latter half of the 5th century and early half of the 6th century. And that was the cause. The entire Buddhist population from South India moved to Sri Lanka. Those who wanted to remain Buddhist moved to Sri Lanka. And their languages, they predominantly used Pali. Prakrit was script. Pali also was a script. All the Buddhist literature up to 300 years ago was only in Pali. Only during the last 300 to 400 years they are writing it in Sinhalese. The script of the Sinhalese language did not come up to about 800 to 900 years ago. There are no inscriptions in Sinhalese. All the inscriptions are either in Tamil or in Prakrit. The Sinhalese words did not exist at the time. The first sustainable literary work was produced 500 years ago in Sinhalese. So you will find all the South Indian languages except Tamil. The evolution was similar. In 1901, we were 25% of the, what we were 100% of the island in 2000 years ago, we were reduced to 25% in 1901 when there was a formal census by the British. Before that, we had no formal census. We are now reduced to 12%. The Islamic population is now 10%. What was in 1909, 4%. In 1909, the Islamic population was less than 4%. The Christian population was less than 4%. Now the Christian population is 8%. All at the cost of Hindus. The Buddhist population has remained more or less static. They never attempt at conversions. Post-independence, we had a very happy life. Pre-independence, in 19... I want to tell you, because this is a very important event, the history of Sri Lanka. In 1915, there were racial riots. The British had, prior to that, brought Muslims as traders to encroach into villages, Sinhalese Buddhist villages and Indian villages. Because they could not market their own produce through Sinhalese traders or Tamil traders, they brought Muslims traders. Now, one incident in Kandy triggered the racial riots. 2000 years of a perehara, Buddhist perehara, procession taking the relics of Buddha in procession in a street where a recent migrant Muslims came and started business, they blocked the program. They blocked the procession. And the ensuing riotous situation, the British favored their own invitees. They favored the Muslims. Not one Muslim was arrested, even though Muslims killed the Buddhists. 5,000 Muslims were arrested. My friend is here from Bengal. There's a Mahabodhi Society that was formed during the time. Anagariya Tharmabala was a Buddhist servant who was working in that area in India, all in Sri Lanka. He was at Calcutta. The British arrested him also. He was in Calcutta, the riots was in Sri Lanka, but he was also arrested by the British. That was the support the British gave to the Muslims. So the Sinhala Buddhists had no leaders outside to vocalize their situation. We had a Hindu leader called Sir Ponnambalam Ramanathan, who was a member of the state council, elected by the Hindus from their traditional areas. He spoke for the Buddhists in the state council. The governor did not relent. That was wartime, World War I. He took a ship, traveled all the way to London, convinced the British decision makers, and got all the 5,000 Buddhists released, including the leaders, Sinhalese. He came back by ship to Colombo. You know what the Sinhalese Buddhist did? When he alighted from the ship in the harbor, he was put in a chariot. Instead of horses, the leaders pulled him up to his house in the chariot. That was the gratitude they showed to the Hindu leader. He proclaimed always that he was a Hindu leader. Sir Ponnambalam Ramanathan proclaimed himself as a Hindu leader all the time. But he supported the Buddhists. If not for him, the history would have changed. Buddhists may not have had the same amount of thrust to seek independence during 1948. So, but forgetting all this, post-independent, the first thing the Buddhists did was to disfranchise Hindus. 10 lakhs of Hindus were disfranchised. 1948 and two bills. One in December 1948 and the other in June 1949. They took away the citizenship in 1948 and they took away the voting rights in 49. 10 lakhs of Hindus who recently migrated from Tamil Nadu to Sri Lanka. That was in 1948 and 49. Immediately, 48, February 4th was the Independence Day. 48 December, the first bill to disfranchise. The second was in 1949. In 1956, another bill was presented in Parliament to make the Sinhala as the official language. When Portuguese came, there were three kingdoms. One was a Hindu kingdom. Saint Francis Xavier from Goa came to Sri Lanka to convert. You know what the Hindu king did? He killed all his followers. And Francis Xavier escaped to India. 626 of them were killed. So we did not tolerate conversion. There was a Buddhist kingdom in the hill country, another Buddhist kingdom in the west coast. There were three kingdoms when the Portuguese came. The first, they conquered the western kingdom, of Sinhalese kingdom. We Hindus supplied arms to them. We sent men to them to protect them from the Portuguese invaders. So The Portuguese thought, and also Indian, at the time India, we had kings, Nayaka kings, post Alauddin Khilji period. Malik Kafur was invading. For 60 years, Malik Kafur plagued South India. The Nayakas from Hampi were able to get it back from Tipu Sultan, Malik Kafur and his followers. And those, they had kingdoms in Tanjore and Madurai. They sent armies to protect the western Buddhist Sinhalese kingdom. So as Hindus, we have protected the Buddhists all through. Whether it was with the Portuguese or with the Dutch or with the British or with the Muslims. But the Sinhalese forgot that. They in 1956 passed a bill in parliament to make Sinhalese as the only language. Only language. No, we were 25% at the time, Hindus and speaking Tamil. Then in 1972, they brought another bill to give Buddhism priority status in the constitution. It was no more secular. It was secular. When the British left, they drafted a constitution which was secular, which did not speak about religion. But the 1972 constitution spoke about the priority given to Buddhist religion in state affairs. So, we Hindus lost the language, the religious position we enjoyed for 10,000 long years in that island, or more, since Ravana's Rama's time. For a section of the people who did not exist before 1,000 years. We lost it at the hands of people who did not exist. A language did not exist before 1,000 years. In the same land, we became language-less. In 1972, we became religion-less. We were second-class or third-class citizens in our own traditional homelands. We did not like it, so we resisted. One Hindu priest in 1958 was burnt inside a Hindu temple. Inside a Hindu temple, he was performing pujas, he was pulled out, kerosene was poured on him, and he was burnt alive. This is the recorded history. That provoked the Hindus to take revenge. Young Hindus to take revenge. And eventually it ended up in a big war that ended up in 2019. The war, the lamp tipping, killed 300,000 Hindus. After 1983, unable to bear the atrocities of a government and a people, the Hindus started migrating. When the war ended, the total number of migrants to other countries were 2.5 million. No, sorry, 1.5 million. 15 lakhs of Hindus migrated during a period of 20 years to 40 countries in the world. When they went there, they remained as Hindus. Not only they remained as Hindus, if you go to France, annually there is a big chariot festival conducted by the Hindus in the heart of the city. So in London, so in Toronto, our person who has come along with me is from Toronto. He is the founder of a Shiva temple. In Switzerland, there are 23 cantons. In each canton, there is a Hindu temple, Shiva temple. In Toronto, in Scarborough, in Quebec, in Vancouver, we have Hindu temples all over. In Italy, we have Hindu temples. So we remain, why I am telling you is when 1.5 million Hindus migrated post 1983, maybe the Buddhist and the Sinhalese were happy. But they did not know that the Hinduism has spread all over the world as a result of the... We have taken Hinduism to countries wherever we went. Maybe the Sinhalese would have said, okay, we have destroyed their temples, we have destroyed their... We have burned their priests, we have burned their properties, took away their language rights, took away their religious rights. Today, you know, 14th of January is the Pongal day, Makara Sankranti. The Canadian Prime Minister celebrated the Pongal day with dhoti and all that. The Singapore Prime Minister celebrated. In London Parliament, there were 10 MPs who were wearing dhotis and celebrating Pongal. Should we not thank? In a way, the riots helped us to propagate Hindu festivals outside, celebrated by... Before, the Canadian Prime Minister never thought about a Pongal day. Now, we are left now with 12.5 lakhs of Hindus, which is 12.5% of it, about 25 lakhs of Hindus in Sri Lanka, which is very much lower than the South Indian Tamil Hindu population in Delhi. The Tamil Hindu population of Sri Lanka is not as big as the Tamil Hindu population of Delhi. Delhi has 30 to 40 lakhs. I understand. I don't know whether it's true. Now, this is the Sri Lankan map showing you the Hindu areas, the densities. Here is the largest density. Then you come. This has been recognized by the Rajiv Jayawardene Accord of the Hindu Homeland. 1987 Rajiv Jayawardene Accord recognized this as a Hindu homeland. The first line states that. The balance, you know, this is the area where the 10 lakhs of Hindus were differentiated. The upcountry plantation area where the recent migrants from India went as plantation workers during the... So much so, you find in 1901 Muslims were like this. And now they are like this. There were small, small traders here and there. They did not make an impact as a population in any district. But now you take the eastern province, they are 45% from here to here. This is the eastern province, starting from here to here, the eastern province. What they were, three centers, now they are 45%. The largest population, single largest population in the eastern province. They have made it here, here, everywhere. So much so, they have made an impact. And the Muslim representation in parliament jumped by 150% during this period of 100 years. There were not even one when the state council was there. Then one or two entered. Now, they are more than the number of Tamil representatives in the parliament. They are Christian. They are Buddhists. Now, this is an example of the atrocities committed by the Christians on Hindus. There's an arch put up by the Hindus to celebrate Mahashivaratri at a temple worshipped by Rama. The temple was, the Shivat Lingam at the temple was worshipped by Rama at the end of the war. We put up an arch on the day before Shivaratri. These are Christian hooligans. They broke the arch. Now, this is another instance where a Christian has, You know, that's a police report in 2017. Here, it was injured. That was a Thiruvadirai day in December. They were taking a procession and the Christians attacked and the boy was injured. This is on Navaratri day. The Muslims entered the sanctorum of the temple, chased a person, cut his head and broke the idols. So I went there to, you know, I was there to help them out with the police and all that. This is in another temple where they have broken up the idols. So there we organized a protest march. No, but this message is that the name of the road for many hundred years was, because there was a temple, the road's name is Vinayaka, Ganapati or Vinayaka Road. Now it is Mosque Road. The name has been removed, the Vinayaka Temple Road name has been removed and it has been renamed. This shows, you know, the government of Sri Lanka appointed a Muslim as a Hindu affairs minister. We protested and, you know, in 2 days time, I wrote a letter to the government saying, scrap the ministry. Instead of appointing a Muslim as a minister, we don't want a ministry for Hindus. There was a cartoon putting my face and saying, why don't you make this man a Islamic affairs minister? Now, these are the areas where the Christians, Buddhists and the Muslims are spearheading their aggressive activities. Here in Mullathivu, the Buddhists have constructed a temple. Here also the Buddhist, here also the Buddhist, here also the Buddhist. These are all areas where the Buddhists have constructed in new temples. There are no Buddhists in the area. There are no Buddhists in that area. Post-war, like any other aggressive government or an army, when the Portuguese came, they started breaking temples and building Christian churches. The Muslims are breaking. Now Buddhists are also doing it. Now this is a story about 4037 persons converted to Islam and Christianity in one district. The MP has, you know, submitted a report in the parliament. He is the MP from Jaffna. A 85% Hindu majority province, Northern Province. He is the vice president of the Methodist Church. And below is his wife. This is his wife. This is the MP. Their full-time job, paid by an evangelistic organization in UK, is to convert. We have an MP who is a priest, who is a converter, a Christian. These are missionaries going about doing conversion work. You know, these are advertisements. Anybody knowing Tamil will know. If you want to change your name, you have to go to the registrar's office and then you have to advertise. Every day in newspapers, minimum 30 such advertisements appear. Minimum 30 such advertisements. Either to Christianity or to Islam. Now, we are posting, look at this poster. Our volunteers are posting, conversionists, do not enter this place. So far, we have posted about 10,000 posters. In various of acute conversion. And, you know, I work for a organization called Shiva Sena in Sri Lanka. So we put the name Shiva Sena here. The name itself is now anathema to Christians and Muslims. They are very much worried. They want to kill me also because we put this. They are writing repeatedly in the social media that I should be eliminated. Because we do this. To put up 15,000 posters in vulnerable areas is a very difficult job. Even the volunteers could be easily attacked. But we are doing it. We are continuously doing it. We are not stopping it. He is Mohan C. Lazarus from Tamil Nadu. You've heard about him. He calls every temple an abode of Satan. He came, there was a poster in Sri Lanka where he is also was also speaking. I went to the police. You can see my name here. I went to the police and complained, this man has come into the country with foreign funds and foreign missionary activity on a tourist visa. So the police banned him. Now he cannot come. He can come on a visa that will allow him to speak at. But the government of Sri Lanka will not give, it does not issue, it does not have a system to issue such visas. They have only tourist visa, business visa, student visa. So he has to come in a tourist visa. He was there in, both of them were banned. They cannot come to Sri Lanka anymore on tourist visa. This is what we are doing. We are on, you know, these are our volunteers. Can you see how they are finding it difficult to climb and putting Nandi flags? Nandi represents Hindu. The last king of Jaffna, Hindu king, who I told you about, Sir Francis Xavier, his flag was Nandi. So we are hosting Nandi flags everywhere. See, in front of every house. And in front of every house, we put a poster. Conversionists don't come. And we provide a book because in most areas, people do not have books on scriptures. So we provide them a book of verses which can be used for each of the 12 months. For Navaratri, the festival scriptures will be there. Sivaratri festival scriptures will be there. New Year festival, all that. Also for last rites, for marriages, for births of children. Because these are the times when the Christian missionaries go. When you have a person who is dead in a house, we have sometimes no priest in that place. So he has to wait until he comes from a distant village. In the meantime, the pastor goes there or the father goes there. Not only he goes with a coffin box. Provide the coffin box. Stay there for some time waiting for the Hindu priest come. Nobody turns up. He starts telling the prayer. He takes the coffin along with the relatives to bury or burn. There also he conducts the prayer. 3 days he provides them with food, everything. Now the family is indebted to the father. So we are providing scripture books with where the family can recite the prayer themselves. And this flag and the poster in front of the house. That's what we are doing. This house is also built. One family, the father was offering the children education in a Christian school. I was asked to intervene. So I went there. I saw the family had no thatched roof. Not even a thatched roof they had. They only had some barricades. No drinking water nearby. This children, the man had suffered injuries during the war. So there was no earning member in the house. So I went to the commander of the army, Jaffna. I told him that this is. So he built this house for them. He's a Buddhist, a good Buddhist. He also does not like conversions. So he built this house, put a tube well for them, and you know. Similarly, he had built many houses, it's at my instance. He's also again, now, he's from Tamil Nadu. His name is He is from Tamil Nadu. His name is Rama Ravi Kumar. We heard that 110 families were about to be converted. I did not know what to do. I telephoned Rama Ravi Kumar. He came. He crossed into and started conducting prayers in the temple. Then went house by house, removed the picture of the Jesus Christ, which he had done, is put on the holy ash on their foreheads, reconverted back to Hindu fold, told them how to pray. He did some missionary work house by house to take back the 110 families which were about to be converted or more or less converted. So this is one girl who was lured into Christianity by the MP whom I showed, the Methodist Mission MP, Sumandran. We landed, after he left, we went there. We told the parents, your daughter is being. So the parents were shocked to hear that they brought the daughter back. We gave her books, we put a flag on and all that, and you know, we got her back into our fold. Now, this is what the MP is writing about our work during. The MP is the president of the vice president of the Methodist Church. He is writing this in the report of the Methodist Church, annual report of the Methodist Church. He is writing that we are a hindrance to his progress of conversion. Now, these are the areas where the Christian missionaries are very active converting. So what we have done is, we have gone with flags, books, and posters. And the name Shivasena is a name they fear now. This is about cow slaughter. We had a procession. And then we had a fast where even a Buddhist priest participated. Buddhist priest, Hindu sadhu, Chinmaya Mission sadhu, myself and many people. We had a fast. And the cow slaughter is a matter for the local councils. It's not a national thing. Any local council can decide whether in its area a cow can be slaughtered for meat or not. So we have, after this fast, 7 local councils have passed resolutions to stop slaughter, even though it's a loss of income for them, because they rent out beef stalls. It's a loss of income, but we persuaded them, went there, and got them to stop auctioning for beef stalls. Eventually, abattoirs were closed. Now we put this post everywhere. 10,000 year tradition of cow protection. Please elect people who will not pass resolution to slaughter cows. We said no more beef stalls. We have processions. This is about a news item where cows are stolen by these fellows too. No, if even you give them a license for one, they will do hundreds during Ramzan. Now, this is a Buddhist local council head. I went all the way driving 400 kilometers down south to congratulate him, this Buddhist priest and this man. And we invited him to Jaffna. And, you know, we felicitated him. Why I am showing you all that is that very difficult. We are working under. Now, this is another felicitation for those members of the 7 local councils in Northern Province. So, these are the, these dots represent the local council where the, you know, 3 plus 4, 7, 8 now. 8 local councils are banned cow's slaughter. Now this is on animal sacrifices. We conducted a fast to stop animal sacrifices. Now we are working on a program. This is where which concerns you. Sri Lanka is a country which has a Hindu population. Where do we go for pilgrimage? To Jerusalem? To Makkah? Where do we go for pilgrimage? To Varanasi, to Ayodhya, to Haridwar, Rishikesh, Chidambaram. Can we go to the West? Can we go to Africa? Can we go to Australia? This is the only land where we can come on pilgrimage. But now the Hindus have to take a long route. Hindus are here, I told you. They all have to come to Colombo. That is the only departing point in India, in Sri Lanka now. No other arrival departure for planes in Sri Lanka. This is only one point. They have to come to Chennai or Trichy. And then, you know, all related expenses. Even for this Sabarimalai, they come in large numbers. Around 1 lakh of people come to Sabarimalai. They have to take this route. It cost one passenger, one pilgrim, about 90,000 Indian rupees. Can I afford it? I can't afford it. I'm telling you, 90,000 is a big sum for me. What about the below the poverty line Hindus, who are the majority after the war, who formed the majority after the war? Can they afford? So they form easy prey to the missionary activities. You have no priest, you have no pilgrimage, you have no temples. What do I do as a normal peasant? If somebody comes and offers me meat, food, prayer at home, take me to the funeral place, offer me even pilgrimage to Jerusalem. What do I do? Oh, I am a Hindu, I will not come. I should be a fool. So I am asking you in India to allow us to travel between these two points. This takes only 2 hours by ship. So that we will take all the Hindus from here straight to Chidambaram and then on to the north by train. That will cost them only 10,000 to 20,000 Indian rupees. That is 1/5 of the cost. 1/5 of the cost, 10,000 to 15,000. Today we both of us paid our hotel bill. For 1 week we are staying in a very good hotel. You know how much we paid? 5,000 to 6,000 each. So that is an affordable price. If the Hindus cannot afford a pilgrimage, I am telling you, you are losing the Hindus. My request to the Hindus in India is, please persuade your government of India to run a ship for us. A pilgrim ship only, nothingness. We want a pilgrim ship. During festival times, not always. We have, you know, a festival in Sivaratri. Sivaratri is a festival. We want to come to India. We want to come to Varanasi. We want to go to Kalahasi. We want to go to Tiruvannamalai. We want to go to Rishikesh. Can we go now? Spending 90,000, 1 lakh Indian rupees. So please let us come this way. Sivaratri is there. The New Year is there. Makara, you know, the April New Year. For all of you, it's New Year, April, for all of us. We want to come and worship at temples. We want to fulfill our vows. We want to emotionally strengthen ourselves. Prayer is the best form of emotional strength. So let us come, please. Let us come here. Every 2 months, we will have some festival. So for 10 days, you can even run one or two ships during that time. Maybe if you can't run every 2 months, you can run it for even 2 ships, 2 times a year. We'll be grateful to India. And you will have brothers in Sri Lanka who will remain as Hindus. Now this is, I am speaking to the governor of the northern province on this. The Sri Lankan government has agreed. You see, and in fact, the government was registering people to go. See, even the Navy has, you see, the Navy wrote to me and said, please arrange for the ship soon. So the Sri Lankan government is fully with us on this. We want India to come to our help. Now, we bring a lot of Indians. You know, I met Honorable Minister Shipping last time when I came. Regarding the ship, nothing came out. You know, our friend Arun Upadhyay, I met the Honorable Minister for External Affairs. We the Hindu delegation, met the Indian High Commission in Sri Lanka. Your Swabdadas Gupta, you remember, your MP in Rajya Sabha, he has written letters to the government of... I told you about a Hindu king who met Francis Xavier's aggressive conversion. He is the one. He was responsible for the massacre of 626 converts Francis Xavier brought from India. In fact, Francis Xavier escaped from India because the Zamorins of Calicut and the Nayakars of South India were driving him madly. He was able to operate in Goa because that was a Portuguese fort. Goa was a Portuguese fortress. But he came down south on missionary evangelistic work. The Zamorins of Calcutta did not allow him. So he came further south to Kanyakumari. The Nayaka kings of South India drove him. So he came to Sri Lanka. So we drove him out. Our king, we drove him out. He brought the converts also. And in the process, his son was killed. Because initially, King Shankli thought there was a small... he sent his son as his... with an army. They imprisoned him. Portuguese army imprisoned the son into supporting Francis Xavier. So he personally went. You should be happy that we did not, for the past 400 years, 500 years of our Hindu existence in Sri Lanka, we have worked against conversions. Not once, not this year. I will tell you an instance in the Dutch period. The Dutch governor suggested that for his fort, one village supplies a cow. The village leader should supply one cow for the fort, the garrison. So people were supplying. But those who did not want to supply escaped to India, took the route I showed you. Took this route. They were here, they just came across. Now we can't come. Both the Sri Lankan Navy and Indian Navy will intercept us and stop us. We cannot come unless otherwise both governments agree and provide it. But at the time when the Dutch wanted to impose their cultural traditions and supply cows to their garrison, we escaped and came to Chidambaram. We have 32 chowdhuries in Chidambaram for visiting pilgrims, only run by us, owned by us. But we don't use it now because we can't come in such large numbers. Now, you see, our friend who's come from Canada is supplying Shivalingas. We are installing Shivalingas in almost all places where they were destroyed already. This is another Shivalinga we have installed. We conduct group meetings. You know, Mr. Sriram is here from Jana Jagruti. This is the Uma from his organization. Uma and Shanpak Vinayak came to Sri Lanka, like Rama Ravi Kumar. Then this is Rama Ravi Kumar who came from India. This is Uma who came from India. Similarly, we have many visitors from India to encourage us. But we don't go for public meetings because the tourists cannot address public meetings. But we can always have prayer meetings inside halls. That is not. And then Ramaravikumar came back to Chennai after seeing the situation, had a photo exhibition of the situation in Sri Lanka. You know, from Bengal, Mr. Tappan Kosh has come to Sri Lanka. This is from the BJP. This is our MP from Sri Lanka. We came and met your BJP. I met Guruji. I met CP Radhakrishnan, MP. Have met, you know, these are my meetings with various people. Seeking your support. This is my, Sri Ram is here. This, you can see, I have gone to Goa several times to attend these meetings, and they now support our activities in a big way. I was in the Chicago conference. This is again Sri Ram's paper where they publish all our news. So you saw the earlier picture where we broken idols. They have carried that in their newspaper. This is our MP in Sri Lanka, in Chennai. Now, this news is very important. I told you that I have threats, sometimes death threats. They have complained to the Sri Lankan government that I was a terrorist. Yeah. You see, I was invited by the terrorism investigation department to be present, and I went there. See, this is a news item saying that I was asked to come for TID. Can you see that? TID is Terrorism Investigation Department. For my work, for what am I doing? Am I a terrorist? But the Muslims have written a letter to the saying that I am a terrorist.
You are one. You have created a terror in them.
See, this is how they write. Shiva Sena is leader, openly anti-Muslim, anti-Christian, bigot.
Bigot is the best one.
See, he says, I am a madman. He's one post, these are posts, but he says, my request to remove Sumandran from the, you know, I wrote a letter asking Sumandran to be taken off the membership from the parliament. See, they say, I am sowing seeds of religious extremism. Can you imagine? See, they are quoting my posters. You know, Madhavala is a Muslim thing. They are putting in their post whatever I said. And they also, this news is about, they say the RAW is giving me funds. See, that type of, see, these are all news about trying to defame me. This says I'm a traitor. I don't know how. See, beefing of anti-Muslim and anti-Christian religious fanaticism by Pradesh Sabha of Nallur is unconstitutional. See, when the local council passed at my request, one fellow writes it's unconstitutional. He happens to be a Hindu.
So we can relate. This happens with us also.
When this is about a complaint to the election commission that we were asking Hindus to vote for to Hindus. This is a complaint. This is a news about an election complaint. This is what I did in 1977. My work started, even then I was doing this work. So, when people think that I have been funded by India recently, have started. So, I had to put this to them and say, no, this is not something new. Okay, I think I have given my best to you. Thank you for listening.